Okay. So, she's a dog.
That dog in there.
You're listening to The Language of Dogs.
What is it? What?
You're not thirsty. You're not touching the water, the orange juice, crab apple. What is it? What am I supposed to do? Make you a margarita?
Obedient owners with happy dogs.
I love you.
I love you.
And now your hosts, Justin Silver and Kristin Hartley.
What is up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of The Language of Dogs. It's your boy, Justin, and guess who's back? Sitting across the couch from me, Kristin is back, everybody.
Oh, yeah, so excited.
I'm so happy to have you back. I'm so happy to see you. We've been quarantined, threw us all over the place, and then in LA, and I'm glad that you're sitting here and you got to meet Brutus, and I missed you.
Oh my God, he's delicious. I miss you so much. It's been enough. It's been long enough.
Yeah. It definitely has. So I'm so glad to have you back, because everybody's been hearing this intro, and now your host, Justin Silver and Kristin Hartley, are like, who is this phantom woman?
Who is it? Like, who is, she's not real.
Who's this mysterious woman?
It's like when a young guy is like, oh, my girlfriend in Canada.
Right.
There is no girl in Canada.
You're a virgin. Okay. Now, we're going to be answering your questions on all things dog in just a moment. And to submit questions for us to answer on this podcast, you can head over to patreon.com/TLOD. We'll answer on podcast or through live video chats, through DMs. You also get early access of this podcast, video training tutorials, live stream demonstrations, product reviews, copies of The Language of Dogs book, and a percentage of your membership goes to our 501c3 charity, Funny for Fido, that rescues shelter dogs. And it's a great way where I can get to know you and know your dogs a little bit better, and you get to know us a little bit, and we can customize your dog dilemmas du jour for solutions that fit you. And if you're digging this show, please show a little support and give a 5-star rating and review on iTunes or wherever you listen. The social media is at The Language of Dogs on Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, and then, of course, YouTube. It is The Language of Dogs for all the training videos. And I want to just give some shouts out to some of our new patrons. What's up, Rocco, Ray, Eric, and Beth? We're going to answer your questions, but first, I wanted to talk to you, and I'm glad that you're here for this, Kristin, because a lot of times there's a parallel between raising dogs and raising kids.
Very much so.
Yeah. And Kristin is a mom of a beautiful boy and a mom of dogs and a devoted wife and a TV producer, and she works her ass off, and she is just an incredibly selfless person who brings me toilet paper when I have COVID, and somehow in her spare time manages to rescue all these special needs dogs, and has a son who has special needs, who is the sweetest little boy, and she's just an amazing person. And so I defer to you with a lot of these things, because there are a lot of parallels. And when I need support for the things that I'm doing with dog training, and not only handling the animals, which I find the easy part, but also negotiating the territory of personalities, and I can get very hot-headed. You're somebody that I consult with, and that calms me down and helps me sort of see things clearly sometimes. So as this came up this week, I thought that you'd be, you know, in my mind, you're not only like my right hand here, but you're also sort of the voice of the listener, because you're somewhere between me and the aliens, like the aliens being the dogs.
Totally.
You know, like I was like, someone's got to be, you know, I can get off on these like scientific kicks and spin people into circles and they're like, wait, what the hell is he talking about? And you're the one who says, wait, what the hell are you talking about? So I need you here. So I took Brutus away to a farm this weekend. It was so beautiful.
Yeah,
right?
I saw that. It was great.
Awesome. It was awesome that New York came out. It was beautiful, right? And he was going to be running around with horses and with goats. And it was just, I love, like, when you take a shelter dog and they were living in a, you just saw the videos.
Filth,
right?
Just living in filth, exhausted, emaciated, like hopeless.
Yeah, he was in ICU for 3 weeks. They were, the Dia at LA Pets of Homeless, who we'll interview eventually.
Please.
She is a saint. But she basically was feeding him and his sister Medusa every day, because they were living outside in this crate on the street, like a makeshift crate on the street, just covered in dirt, and it looked like tar. His scrotum was covered in blood from the hot pavement. And then she was like, you know, one day they were just gone for a month and they came back and she was like, they were evaporating. So she asked him to surrender. And then he went over to I Stand With My Pack. And then this trainer, John, had him for a little while. They put some meat on him. And now here he is living, tripping the lights fandango. Is that easy? I always feel like it's living the lights fantastic. I don't know how to say it. Anyway, so I love like taking them from those places and just exposing them to this awesome life because, you know, that's how we do it over here. We live in Illuminati style. So he was on this farm and he's running around and he was so interested in the horses and the goats and he was playing around with them. And one of the things that made it so possible is I put him on the e-collar. Now, I put the e-collar on vibrate. And I first conditioned him here in the city to I just did it for recalls. I just wanted it for recalls. His commands are great once he's, like, right near me. And then the way we do it is, like, I hit the buzz of the collar. It vibrates. And then he's like, oh, what's that? And it sort of, like, just breaks the attention of what he's doing. He runs right over to me. And then I'll ask him to, like, sit. And then I always finish it with a reward. So it's this positive reinforcement experience.
It's a whole cycle. It's not just, like, this thing that you just hit it and that's it. There's an entire, like, graduation to it.
Yeah. So yeah. Well, the button is the prompt to start the repetition.
Right.
Right. So then I get all these DMs from people saying,
"Oh, here we go."
No, these are these were kind of good ones, and I had these exchanges with people. They saying, "Oh, I always thought that those were bad. Like, are you shocking him, or is it?" And I had to like explain this to people, and I know the answer to this. And I go, "Well, where did you hear that?" And they go, "Well, I follow this, and I'm going to explain the heresy in this statement right now." They go, "Well, I watched this positive reinforcement trainer on YouTube who says prong collars and e-collars are bad." Well, because there's the possibility that you can hurt dogs with them. Yes, there are. You could also hurt a dog with a shoe, but shoes aren't bad. You know, I fed Brutus a watermelon this weekend. I also could have slammed it over his head if I wanted to. But the thing that really drives me crazy about this is when people take a stance on something, and instead of saying, like, wait a second, this is not something that I know how to use or I know how to use safely, so I'm going to now demonize it and not explain to people that there are probably safe and painless ways of using these things, but I just don't know how to use them. And so then they demonize the equipment and they say, well, this is a negative reinforcement tool. And then they're not explaining the most important part, that there's an education process of how to use all these tools. And if you look in my dog training closet, right, there's front lead harnesses, there's halties in there, there's martingales, there's prong collars, there's soft prong collars, there's e-collars. I try to keep as open mind as possible because I always think that comes from like a place of insecurity.
Well, you have something for everyone, because the thing of it is that all of these dogs, you have to take an individualized approach.
There is no one-size-fits-all approach to dog training. And
no.
And here's where and I understand that these people are mean well. And they want to be like, well, we want to go with the softest, gentlest way of doing it. And when you go on blogs where they say, listen, you go on like certain blogs that are like animal welfare blogs, and they go, they'll tell you what collars to use, what collars not to use. So they'll say, so the ones that can be used, the ones that are, you can hurt a dog with anything. You can hurt a dog with a harness. I showed a video of when counterpulling happens and how many dogs, like especially dachshunds that I see, end up with spinal injuries because the harness is clipping to the middle, so it causes bowing in their spine. You could hurt dogs with anything. But I understand that because there are people who take the shock collar and put it on 100 and zap dogs and use it to punish them, or people who put prong collars around dogs that can snap the hell out of them, that it's like, well, then these things are bad. But the trainers who use these things responsibly and educate people on how to use subtle pressure, they can be game changers. And here's why I think that it's so irresponsible and why I think it's so selfish. And I'm open to suggestions on this, because I see a lot of people who, I'm the fifth trainer that they've seen.
Yes, or more.
Sometimes.
I've had to refer people to you where you were like the ninth trainer.
Sometimes. And a lot of these people have banged their head against the wall, and they've seen, and I'll ask them how people have come to me. And I'm not certainly not the only game in town. I'm not suggesting that. But I ask them like who they worked with before. And they're saying like my dog pulls and lunges. Let's say dogs pulling and lunging at other dogs. Things that are really problematic can either get dogs hurt or get their dogs hurt or other dogs hurt. And they saw trainers who had, you know, a limited armamentarium in their toolbox and a limited way of thinking about how dogs should be trained. And then when at first they didn't get the results, they got strung out for like a 10-session package, which I'm like, that's a fortune, right? And then when that didn't work, they were given this diagnosis, which is like, well, you know what? This dog's just untrainable. And they were then suggested that they should get rid of it or suggested that the dog should be put down. And I'm like, instead of saying like, listen, and if those people said, well, what about if I use a prong collar? No, 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 don't use those. Those are bad, right? So why I think that's selfish is because it's not your influence, your suggestions influence other people, right?
Absolutely.
If I have a plumber come to my house and he's only got three wrenches and I have a flood and he goes, you know what? My wrenches don't work to fix this flood. The plumbing here is bad. You should move out.
Yep.
Well, the counter, you know, the parallel to that with dogs is like, well, this dog can't be fixed. You should get rid of it. As opposed to saying, keeping an open mind, saying there are possible other suggestions. There are other solutions. I don't know how to use them, but find the responsible trainer who knows how to use those things safely and see if that route works for you. Listen, you have a special needs child, right?
Yes.
He does not learn
no.
in the same fashion that the other kids in that class learn.
Not even a little.
And if you had a teacher who said, well, listen, this is the way we teach here and he's just not getting it, this kid's stupid.
You literally just explained most of public education,
But explain that from a parenting point of view.
Well, I also think the thing of it is that, and this is one of the reasons why I always end up referring people to you, and it's the same with my son and with special needs kids, of that you have to look at each animal and each child, and you have to understand that there needs to be an individualized approach.
100%.
So with education in general, especially education with special needs kids, and then also with dog training, this has really only been around for between 50 to 75 years. So that's not a lot of time. And so for the longest time, for both working with, you know, kids that needed what we call extra, and then you have dogs that have, you know, different issues, because dogs are like people, and you and I both know a lot of people with issues. you know, it's taken the last like 75 years for people to understand that there has to be an individualized approach. And in order to do that, you kind of have to get to know the person a little bit, the child a little bit,
yeah.
the dog a little bit. And a lot of what you see with teachers and with trainers, and it's the same with like therapists, for example. You know, you have your other podcast.
Neurotica.
Neurotica.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with mental health. Like there can never be just one blanket approach. Everything has to be individualized. And so, for example, to your point where you're talking about the different types of collars, someone would look at a certain collar, like a prong collar is always considered, oh my goodness, by people who don't really know much about prong collars. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, they're beastly. You're hurting the dog. But like, for example, to bring it back to my son, he has such bad ADHD, and that's like one of the seven things that he has, that there are times where I have to clap my hands together really loud, very sharply, very staccato, and it's like a gun just went off.
Mm-hmm.
And
Kristen's Italian.
It's and Jewish. That's why I have caretaker syndrome. But I have to like really be like, I will actually also have to pull the mic away and I'll have to go, "Hey!" like at him. And another parent would be like, "Oh my God, what the hell is that?" But it's because he's so like focused on like what he's like doing, they have problems like transitioning, that if I don't like wake him up, if
yeah.
I don't do something to snap him too, and he doesn't see it as like, oh, you know, like you just scared me, or
right.
you just disciplined me.
You're not hitting him over the head with a sledgehammer.
Right. It's the
right.
same thing with the buzzer of like, you're like, oh, what's up?
Yeah. Well,
sorry. Did you have something? Did you need me? Did
now,
you have something to say?
And it's not. Listen, if people don't know how to use
right.
these things properly, there's dogs that have anxiety issues, right? So I'm working with this dog last week, and I was like, they wanted to learn how to use this collar because they're like, he gets ball obsessed. So I said, well, put it on practice in the house so it's not foreign from when we're first on session. So she's like, well, I put the collar around his neck and I hit the vibration button, and then he didn't know what it was, and then hit under the bed for an hour. And I go, well, that's not the way you'd. So you could give.
So
a
that means you didn't check the setting.
So. No. It wasn't a setting. They don't know what the buzz is. Nothing. The
right.
It's the equivalent of your cell phone vibrating. But if it's just this random thing that you don't pair with a reward, then it has no meaning. And the fact that it has no meaning doesn't complete the circle. So back to what I was saying about positive reinforcement. So let me explain this. Now, all dogs are trained in the four quadrants of operant conditioning. All animals learn that way, from dogs to horses to rhinoceros to elephants to cockroaches, which means positive means adding, reinforcement means to increase behavior, negative means removing, punishment means to decrease behavior. So now, positive reinforcement goes hand in hand with negative punishment. But who in their right mind, if they knew nothing about dog training, would go sign up for a session from somebody that says, I practice positive reinforcement and negative punishment? Because that word sounds so bad. But let me give you an example of negative punishment. Ready? If my dog is chewing a ball on the bed and I want him off the bed and I take the ball away so that he jumps off the bed, that's negative punishment.
Right. As opposed to like people you see that grab the dog by the collar and just drag him off the bed.
That's abuse. Right. So negative punishment
is... So let's
draw
the line between negative reinforcement and abusive.
And there are no... There's no such thing as a tool that is a negative reinforcement tool, because as I just explained, of course, you could use a prong collar to yank a dog, but you could yank a dog with anything. Your intention is everything, and the skill set is everything. So for example, if I... When we talk about that circle of Brutus was eating horse shit at one point. So I hit the buzzer and it buzzed and he goes, what? So I go, come here. So he comes to me. I go, sit, lay down. I count to three and then I give him the reward for it. The buzz,
which is not the horse shit.
The buzz of the e-collar was just the prompt
to
start the circuit. It's got nothing to do. And even if I put the, and by the way, I put the collar on my neck and I put the stim on.
Yes.
And the stim on the low settings, like I didn't feel anything till it hit about like 28.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't really even necessary to use it at that point. So it was like, it did. The point isn't like, well, let me just, if you go on websites that say like, you know, don't use this thing ever. And I'm like, well, what about on the vibration mode? It's like they're too busy defending a point. And I think that there's such a disservice because, listen, as dog trainers, which everybody is, if you have a dog, you are a dog trainer. What I suggest people do is learn firsthand from people who know what they're doing and from people who you feel comfortable with, who can assure you that they know how to use these things safely and use them on their own dogs in ways where you don't think that this is sketchy or you don't think that this is punishment. In the form of abuse, and can educate you on these things so you make firsthand decisions because you know what's best for your dog. And the more, listen, in the expert's mind, there are few solutions. In the beginner's mind, there are many. Right?
Right.
That's what my old business partner, Dave, used to tell me all the time. And people who are know-it-alls, and they're like, no, this is the fixed way I learned, this is how to do it. Know-it-alls don't end up knowing as much as people who keep open minds because they always want to explore. And when I started training dogs, I was like, I want to learn as much as possible. And the reason I know a lot is because I'm not a know-it-all who goes, this is the way. That's not. Those people are bad. And I think that just comes from insecurity. And the truth is, and then I'll shut up in a minute because I know you love to cut me off, because I know the truth is, when you listen, forget about YouTube channels, okay? I have a YouTube channel that we're building up now, and it's small because we just started it and we're building it, right? But I've had TV shows on national networks.
International.
And I've had TV shows in other countries, right? Dogs in the City showed in 47 different countries. Good Doctors was in Hong Kong. I've written books, and these are not...
Self-published.
Self-published. Thank you. I'm stupid. No. These are not self-published books. They're like Simon & Schuster had to give me a book deal. That's a difficult thing to do. And those production companies, those are $500,000 an episode productions. I know what goes on in editing rooms, right?
You do?
So I understand the ins and outs of that. And when I was on TV, and I'm not going to say who this is, right? There was another dog trainer, right? Don't even guess because it doesn't matter, right? There was another dog trainer. And the way they wanted to paint the picture of some of these solutions were, well, I'm not going to say he or she. They want to show that here's an abused shelter dog, and if we just show this dog and is lunging and barking at the dogs, and if we just show this dog that the world is a happy place,
No. This
dog is going to adjust and realize, and if people just give him treats all the time, people are going to realize, the dog's going to realize that the world is a happy place and these issues are going to go away. And in TV, there's a script that they want to follow. And they reached out to me and they said, "Would you do the training of this dog?" And I was just like, "What?" I didn't even know this existed at this point. They asked me, and they explained it to me because we had the same production company. They said, "Well, the way we do some of these episodes is with the difficult dogs, we have trainers come in to do the training, and then they just sort of finish the story for the narrative." And I was just like, "That sucks." And no, I won't do that because I'd feel like a fraud, and I would think the person who is the character of the trainer on the show would feel full of shit too. And the one thing that I've always stood by is my honesty and my integrity. And there were times on Dogs in the City where they're like, "Well, will you do this and we do that?" I go, "No, because I don't remember. Do this or I don't do that."
Yeah.
And there were episodes that I thought that show was corny. But there were episodes, I thought it was cute, but I thought it was corny. There were episodes where I was just like, you know, where I had to take the English bulldog. They were like, you know, it was
Beefy.
No. Oh. The one that was up in that the millionaire's apartment.
Oh, yes, that
and
one.
And it was like, I was like, "Let me go take this dog somewhere fun to play," right? And I was like, "Let's go take it out to a farm where it can run around and play in mud." And they're like, "Well, we don't have that. Let's just use this indoor dog daycare." So I had to make it like they were having so much fun. But I was like, "I don't take my dogs to places like that." That's where I was willing to capitulate a little bit. But when it came to like the actual, like, here's how these things are done because I want to help it, like, I was inflexible when it came to that because I was like, integrity means a lot to me.
And it should.
And when you have, and the truth is, and this is myself included, people on YouTube, people on their Instagram channels, they want to sell you what they know and they want to sell you what they believe in. And the more you are loyal to their style and their way of doing things, the more you're not going other places. And if you're not going other places, they kind of have you there. And it's like that makes them money. And it's not that these people aren't good natured or know what they're doing, but it's like if they're giving advice out where they go on and make a video, they go, "These things are bad." Without the education that there is a range of how to use everything, it's like that's misinformation. It's just misinformation. And misinformation is harmful, especially when you're standing on a pedestal where people look to you for solutions. And that's all and you can listen to me, you can listen to anybody. But like my what I suggest to people is like don't demonize things unless you find the people who know it know how to use them safely. Because for every video you see demonizing them, you'll find the expert who goes, "Hey, everybody, let me show you how to use..." You'll find that too.
Right.
The well, internet is just full of all of it.
It is. And you have to think of this, like life in general and searching for information is no different than a second grade science experiment. You can work something to give you any outcome.
Yeah.
You already have in mind, like they tried to do with your TV show of like, this is where we want this story to go. We're going to build it this way. So I think that you're absolutely right. But I would also offer to our wonderful listeners, because I've been guilty of this myself, is that when you don't know something and you are in a state, like whether you've got a dog or a child, you have a situation or like, you know, your sink just busted and you're like, "I'm going to go on YouTube and figure out how to do this myself." Or when Colin first started getting diagnosed a couple of years ago and I just started inhaling every podcast, every book, every website. So I think what happens is when people are very hungry to learn something and you come across someone who's like, "This, yes, that bad," you go, "Okay,
right.
This, yes,
it
and that bad."
Dogma. It
but what,
dogma.
Right. And what happens is what I would recommend to our listeners, exactly what you're saying, but also take it one step further, which is what, you know, myself and those of us moms in the special needs community have to do, is that different experts and different people are going to have different sort of opinions.
Yeah.
So get a few of those highly qualified people like you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And when you sort of see who those different sort of people are and what those opinions are,
yeah,
then you can kind of like piece those things together, because there are quite a few trainers out there that do speak very highly of using things like the buzz collar or an e-collar, because they are people that believe in an individualized approach. And so I would say just keep digging
right.
to those specific people right. like you're talking about and watch more than a few. And that will help you get that deprogramming of, well, I saw that one person
right.
who is an expert. So now I'm done.
Right.
And I don't need to like research it anymore. Like now I just do that.
Right.
And that's not how it works.
And Kristin, it goes both ways. You also have the people who are like, you know, we're the e-collar prong collar people. It's
yes.
like, no, man, you want to be the, I take an open-minded approach.
You got
to
figure
and
this out.
And there is no one-size-fits-all prescription to dog training, and know how to use different things. And just like that guy under my sink, he's like, he had an Allen wrench. He had 90 different wrenches. He figured out the right one.
But part of the reason why he has all those wrenches is because he's showing up and he has no idea what sink you have. He has no idea what are those things, bugs, lutz. I don't know what they're
nuts.
Called.
Nuts.
Said nuts.
I don't know. We don't fix things here.
So that's one of the reasons why he has all the different tools is because, again, it's all about an individualized approach.
Correct.
We are fastly starting to realize as a society that a one-size-fits-all doesn't work. It doesn't work for pizza. It doesn't work for your plumbing. And it shouldn't work for your dogs or your kids.
It shouldn't. And a lot of times people come for sessions, they want to learn how to use different things or they have prejudice about different things. And I go, well, let's try a few of these to see which... I have to make sure that people feel comfortable using the tools. So I'll introduce them to a bunch, and then they're like, oh, I really want to use this collar the way you used it. But I'm like, I don't think you're ready yet because you're going to be too herky-jerky on the leash. Like, let's say someone wants to use the prong collar, right? And I think that they're uncoordinated, and I think they're going to – it's called slamming, like when the collar
yes.
goes hard. What I like to do is I don't use more than like a pound of pressure, and I isolate the movement, and then the dog will just sort of settle. I don't ever pop collars. So what I'll do is I'll start them on the martingale. Then I'll go to the star mark prong, which is the one, the plastic one, and I'll file it down.
Like that's interesting.
I file it down so that
you should do that for the YouTube channel. You should. Show
I'm going to.
How
I'm.
To do
I'm going to do this whole video, which is collars explained. I'm going to explain everything. Then, if they have success on that and they understand the subtlety of how to do it, like you don't put someone who's just started driving in a Lamborghini. It's like they're going to fly off the road. So then,
not unless you live in Westport, Connecticut.
Right. So then I put them. So then we work up to it because their skill set has to be. Their hand has to be guided. You know what I'm saying? It's like in boxing, right? You don't train with 6 ounce gloves on. You train with 20 ounce gloves on so you don't hurt anybody. And that's how we do it. We do it slowly and incrementally. And there's amazing dog trainers out there. There's guys that I learn from and I ask questions to. There's other people on YouTube, but I was like, man, this dude knows his stuff. And a lot of men, a lot of women, all across the board. But it's like, it's really up, you know, someone's success is not synonymous with their skill set. And as someone who's in entertainment and know that, where there's a lot of like randomness to that, and someone can make really kitschy sort of social media videos, and you're like, oh, I love this person, great personality. But you really, like, it's our jobs as individual dog owners to really kind of separate the truth from the heresy. So I just wanted to share that with you all. And before we answer your questions, I do want to talk about one more interesting thing.
Okay.
So I have this dog that I train virtually, Cairo, this beautiful tricolor pit bull, and his two moms. They are so delightful. This dog is gorgeous, like the type of dog that I would take. So we're working on this dog's reactivity, and it's nothing that I would think is like, to me, reactivity doesn't mean like dogs. If a dog has aggressive expressions, it doesn't mean this is an aggressive dog. I'm like, no, they're reacting to something. And a lot of times they're being protective of their owners. And if the owners don't have a skill set where they're communicating to the dog that they're off duty and they don't have a responsibility to protect them, that'll go by the wayside. They respond to the information that's in front of them. So you're communicating with them whether you want to or you don't want to, right? The great thing about big dogs that express that is like you're not going to get away with it the way you would if your Yorkie's being yappy and annoying, which is why I think that small dogs should be trained with the same skill set that big dogs, because small dogs are whole dogs. So as we're working on this reactivity, they asked me this question. And I was like, man, I should say this on podcast because a lot of people probably go through this. They said the one area we're really struggling with is in the building because of the elevator. And they said, we have to use the freight elevator because dogs are not allowed in the other elevator. So a lot of times when we come out of the elevator, we have him by our side. There's just another dog ready to go in. And then like us, you know, that's the place where dogs are going to be the most protective. They're It's a bottleneck. They're in a small space. It's their home. So I said, and I know the answer to this question. I said, what floor do you live on? They said the 11th. Please don't ask us to take 11 flights down. I said, what percentage, tell me what floor you normally have interactions in with other dogs. And they said, well, the first floor. I said, so get off at 2 and walk down a flight. And they're like, oh, shit, I never thought of that.
Mind blown.
And I was like, get off at 2.
Shit, I didn't even think of that.
Get off at 2 and walk down. And I explained to them also how to put the dog on the far side, you know, using rewards, making them sit, opening the door big, say, excuse, you know, there's ways to do it. But I said, if you're looking for, we're thinking about everything as a bank account, right? If we're trying to train a dog for reactivity, every dog that barks in his face and causes a reaction that we're not able to yield, right, we have a withdrawal. Every time we walk by a dog and we have a positive experience, we have a deposit. If this is a place where we know there's going to be a lot of withdrawals that we can't control, let's try to make it easier on him.
See, I love what you're saying because, and this is a question that I have is, you know, I've been doing this for a while with you, but, you know, I still learn things constantly from lots of wonderful people, especially
me
you.
Too.
And so my question is talk to me really quickly a little bit about, because when you are somebody that is not as experienced with training, you sort of kind of like what we were talking about before is you're like, oh, well, we're not supposed to avoid. We're supposed to continue to try to put
Correct.
Dogs in positive situations. But technically, you just came up with a solve that's like part positive, but also part avoidance. Not necessarily the word avoid, because I think the word avoid has
no,
a negative connotation.
I gotcha.
So can you talk about like any other instances
yeah.
where you feel like having that kind of like creative avoidance
sure.
actually is beneficial
sure.
as opposed to always just trying to muscle through?
If I'm an athlete and I have a knee injury that I'm rehabilitating, there's probably certain exercises that are going to irritate it. That doesn't mean I shouldn't walk, right? So as I'm training these people, we do it virtually, and it's amazing, the stuff, like, because I first show them the techniques, then we go to a park where there's other dogs. I say, now let's use these techniques. Let's start with distance, and then we narrow the gap. Now, would I intentionally put that dog in a situation where let's bring the dog into a small room with another dog and an owner who doesn't know you're on the other side of a door and let that door open and see what, would I do that? No. So as we're in the process of rehabilitating this knee, I don't want them doing squats with too much weight on the bar. So we'll build up to that.
Right.
And if we get to the point where it's like I have a knee injury, I can and I lift weights, but I can't ever put the weight above my waist. So I can do lunges, I can do all these different things, but the bar doesn't go on my shoulders. So what? So if we get this point, like I've had dogs, I had Chiquita and Pacino. The dog park was just not an environment that I can control that was okay for them. That doesn't mean they didn't have tons of dog friends. So we're trying to get these dogs as good as they can be and control the environment as much as possible so that we can set them up for success. So I don't want them – so if getting off on the second floor so they can go out on a walk to go to a public park where they can practice their repetitions of passing other dogs – why not just avoid the chaos?
In a more open, non-reactive environment than this is my house, this is your house, the door opens, yeah. and let's see what happens.
Right.
It's like Vegas.
So it's just, so that's how it is. And there's a million,
right.
so we're always, and so it's like, it's again, you said we're supposed to or we're not supposed to. There is no supposed tos. We gauge what we're doing as we're doing it. And things change. They change day to day, moment to moment. And what I try to educate people is on how dogs think and learn, how to read their dogs in the moment. Because when I'm training, I don't have a plan. I mean, I have a plan because I've done it so many times. It's like the plumber. Like, the plumber comes in and knows ultimately how to fix a sink, but it's like they're variables.
He's got to look around. That's the thing that works about why you as a trainer is because you actually take the time to try to actually see what this dog is, see it, it's an environment, show me what you're seeing,
yeah.
like that kind of thing, which
yeah.
is why I don't care for, and not to be disparaging, I have a very close friend right now who did the whole, I'm going to drop my dog off for 10 days and pick up some like weirdly, like perfectly programmed robot dog. I've never seen those programs work, but that's one of the reasons why I'm not a fan of those programs is because they don't know your dog. They don't know your dog in its home environment. They don't know your dog in the environment of its neighborhood. And so, but...
Well, here's the other side of that.
Personalized approach.
Well, here's the other side of that. But they do know dogs, and they probably know dogs better than the owner knows. Like, they know dogs better than the owner knows dogs.
Oh, no, for sure.
Just like,
yeah.
just like, just like a kindergarten teacher probably knows kids better than a single parent. However, a lot of those programs are great if people are, if there's something specific. So for example, Harley, right?
Yeah.
Harley's, you see her in a lot of my videos, right? Mm-hmm. Brittany uses a lot of different collars with Harley. She uses the e-collar, she uses different collars, right? And when she went away, she had to go on a trip, and she was like, and I have my, a trainer that I work with named Ebony, who is like, she trains these Belgian Malinois and turns them into robots. Now, Brittany was going to do the work of learning all the things. She works with me. She works with Ebony. So when she went away, she was like, instead of sending Harley to a daycare, I'm sending her to board and train, knowing that I'm picking her up and I'm going to continue this. However, when people have the mindset, they're like, no. I'm bringing my cable box to the store, and then they're going to hand it back to me programmed, and I'm just going to have a remote control. That's never going to work. So it's different if you're using it for specific things. You're trying to train dog. Like when I go out of town, I'm going to send Brutus to Ebony because I'm like, she's going to pick up where I left off. He's going to learn a few more things that I know. But like, if there's stuff that I don't know that she knows, it'll take me 10 seconds to figure that stuff out. So those things can work in specific instances, but sort of as a one-stop shop solution to your problems that are then going to come right back when you're in a different environment. It's like dogs are different in different environments. I said it like this. I was like, you drive different when there's a cop car next to you than you do when there's not.
Drive very different when there's a cop car.
So they're going to behave very differently when there's a trainer there versus you. It's like, and if you just, you know, I baby talk them on the couch and I don't follow through and I don't, then they're going to resort back to it. It's the same thing
with kids. Anybody who has kids knows that they're just totally awful when they're with their parents. And with everyone else, they're just delightful.
Well, how many dogs do I have here, right?
A lot.
Not at the moment, but usually. We just have Brutus in a coma. But like, how many dogs do I have here where it's Arthur, Gustav, like, they're completely different with me.
And everybody, right. But also, they also sort of like, it's kind of like they know they can't get away with anything.
No.
It's the same thing with like, you know, same thing with kids and like, you know, grandparents of like, oh, they're totally going to let me have like 5 ice creams today. Like once dogs are like with you, they're like, oh, I got to be on my shit because otherwise like he's not having it.
No. So there's a way of thinking about these things. And all I want to do is encourage people. It's like, you know, the internet is a wacky place. And like Kristin said, it's like when people are sort of like, I'm strapped here. What do I do? There is no one size fits all solution. But if you're looking for somebody to give you a way of thinking that is going to open up possibilities of solutions, you could listen to me. There's a lot of other people that are great to listen to. Look for the people who are very open-minded and know how to use all these things. And if they can explain to you where there's the checks and liabilities of every different tool and why this tool might be good for this dog and not that dog. Like, there's plenty of dogs that I'm like, I don't think this would be good for them. There's plenty of dogs that I'm like, no, the front harness is the way to go because I think, you know, the sound of the chain on the martingale may make them upset. Like, there's I flip things around a million different ways. If I go somewhere for training, like, I have a duffel bag full of stuff.
Yes.
You know, and I'm going to figure out what we need at the moment. Okay, so let's get to some of these questions.
Okay.
Kristin is the voice of you.
Okay. So these listener questions have been on fire lately.
Yeah, they've been good.
Last week was really, really good. Okay. So we got our first one here. So this is from Kim. Hi, Justin. Just wondering when a good age is to switch my new puppy from the dry food the breeder gave us to one of those, quote, real foods you're always suggesting. Also, he had some bad diarrhea for a week, and the vet gave us prescription food. So, should I just stay on this? Thanks for all the content you put out. We're already 3 into the big 6, and the info on the reward schedule is teaching him to be super polite.
Awesome.
I love this question because I actually have this as a constant question / problem in rescue. Because I, like, right now I have a Chihuahua from Puerto Rico, and I would love to get him off this like horrible.
Does it wear a backwards Yankee hat?
No, he's a little too skittish to wear anything right now. So,
but
that happens to us in rescue all the time, where they, especially when they come from other countries, they come with this like kibble.
Yeah,
but they've already been traumatized. They're in a new place, and so just this question in general, I love because like, when do you get them off the bad stuff and onto the good stuff?
So, well, first of all, let's go into the prescription food. So prescription food is really just limited ingredient food. Now, prescription food at vets, there's no real medicine in this food, but what it tends to be very bland and limited ingredients. So there's also, depending on the company, there's also a lot of stuff in there that I wouldn't give dogs. There can be a synthetic mineral pack. There can be a lot of meal and byproduct. If you see the words meal and byproduct, I just say get rid of it, right? So what I try to first do when it comes to dogs that have upset stomachs, it's fine if they're on the food that the vet gives them for a little while, but ultimately I want to get to a more nutritious version of that style of food that doesn't really have all these byproducts in it. So if they're on, like, if they need to eat something very bland, what I'll do is I'll make, let's say they don't have a chicken allergy. Of course, allergies play a part in this as well. But let's say they just should be on, it's a chicken rice formula. I'm like, well, then I would just boil chicken and give them rice and sweet potatoes and just sort of keep it a limited ingredient. So a lot of times when they're on prescription food, it's just something to harden their stomach. It's just something to settle their stomach a little bit. And there's a lot of other ways to do that. So when clients tell me when it's this exact same thing, if they're like, well, the vet wants us on this food long term, I'm like, is there a healthier version of what they're trying to accomplish? Because it's also, you know, a lot of these companies subsidize vets' bills, and so they're paying to be on those shelves. Just like a doctor that's like, we think this antidepressant's the one for you. And it's like, well, what a coincidence, because I'm holding a pen and there's a pad with the name of that on it, right? So let's just sort of think adult here. If dogs don't have stomach issues, or the thing is with puppies or rescue dogs is with puppies, they're just like children. They have to eat very basic, and then you add ingredients. And the more variety, we did an episode on this called Nutrition, the more variety, the better, right? But you slowly and incrementally adjust their stomachs to new things. So I like to have a large variety of foods. And if you watch my Instagram, I'll be like, hey, everybody, today I'm feeding Brutus his Darwin's pet food, and then here's some canned mackerel, and I'm putting, you know, when I add the canned mackerel, I up the rice and the sweet potato content, and I just give them a little bit and work it in, because anytime the fat content goes up and down, that's when their stomachs will get really loose. So a puppy getting diarrhea is a very common thing. It doesn't, now there may be certain things that they shouldn't have, or maybe they ate something that they shouldn't. They're also picking stuff off the floor all the time. If you have, you know, Brutus is like a garbage mouth. I live in New York City. I've pulled more chicken bones out of his mouth. I mean, I'm like, this is the financial center of the world, and there's just dead animals all over the floor. Like, what is with?
Specifically chicken bones.
It's unbelievable. People are just walking down the street, just throwing chicken bones. But so they're sampling a lot of things for the first time. Some things they shouldn't, some things they shouldn't. But you build it up slowly and incrementally. And by adding grains to their food, grains that they, you know, I think whole grains, like I like to use oatmeal or white rice. I don't think there's a big difference between white or brown rice. And then sweet potatoes or a probiotic, like Scout's Honor makes that probiotic digestive chew that we love. And there's a lot of companies that do that. It sort of keeps them consistent on the way. When it comes to real foods, at first, you know, I feed Darwin's raw, but I cook it. Why do I cook it? Because when food goes through a processing plant, it's going through machinery. The machinery is grinding it up. That doesn't mean the sources of the meat are contaminated. However, based on how that processing plant cleans that machinery, there's chances of bacteria. Now, dogs that have really solid stomachs and are older are going to have built-up immunities for that. Puppies are not. So when I take foods like Darwin's, I just cook it and I add rice and I add sweet potatoes. And I've noticed that when you do that transition, it can go really quick. Once this dog gets through its upset stomach, it's fine to switch to another one of those whole pepper. There's the farmer's dog. I would say either cook it or go with one that already cooks it. And you can determine whether it has grain or it doesn't have grain, but you can figure that out. But in terms of the timing, I get dogs off dry puppy food as soon as possible because I don't want dry food in my dog, period. And I don't want the byproducts in them, period. And at the transition, when you do it properly, and I've explained how to do the transitions, and you can also, you know, again, on Patreon, if someone's asked me a question, I follow up with this if they need more information. I can explain to you how to do that and customize it because every dog is different. But there's so much information. There's information, like we said, like I was talking earlier, there's people like, don't ever feed dogs raw. Why? Because I had a bad experience with it. Okay, I guess you're the world now. And people like, my dog's great on dry. What the hell is everybody talking about? I was like, well, my uncle lived to 97 and he smoked cigarettes the whole time. Is that, you know, I'm not like, hey, everybody, go smoke and gamble like my uncle did, right? So Brutus just joined us on the couch. So that's my answer. And with the rescues, it's sort of the same thing. Sweet Pea, who I rescued, his stomach was a mess. his stomach was a mess. And so what I did with him was I watered him on Darwin's. I cooked it, and I made sure that, like, I didn't give him the duck. I gave him the turkey because it was the leanest, and I added oatmeal and sweet potato to it, and I finally got it to the point where his stomach was really consistent and good on that. But for a lot of dogs, like I have Buna in L.A., the Darwin's is too rich for her, so we went to Sojo's, which I also like having like a dehydrated version of food for when you're traveling.
Sojo's is great.
Yeah, it's great. So I use a lot of different foods, but I don't think, you know, the day they arrive, the day a puppy arrives, I don't switch their food because there's a lot of new things going on there. Like, let them settle and sort of, you got to sort of see
and how
what
long
they're...
would you recommend for like a puppy specifically? Because it's different for seniors, it's different for, you know, middle-aged dogs.
A week. I mean, okay. If they're settled and they're sort of they're not as anxious. Sometimes they're not anxious at all. But if they're eliminating regularly, and you know, your house is going to have, they're going to be exposed to different things in your house than they are at the breeder's house. It's a different environment. So who knows what they're picking up off the floor? And if it's like, you know, another thing is like if you live in a city and then you don't take your shoes off when you first come in, it's like there's stuff on the floor, you know, there's all these different variables. But once they're sort of consistent, like a week of that, and then you can start experimenting.
Got it.
You know?
Okay.
Cool.
So we're going to move on to, this is from Lawrence and Beth. Ooh, two people. Hey guys. So as we learn more and more about training our 1.5-year-old Westie, Penelope.
Cute.
She's becoming a very balanced and happy girl. We realized that she was floating through this world as you have taught us, and all her terrier reactions were normal because we were in the observant position, waiting to see what she does, then reacting and trying to correct it. The change has been a complete 180. She used to meet dogs in front of us and either play immediately or get really tense and lunge and snap. Now she looks up at us as if to say, is it okay for me to say hi? Then she approaches them calmer, and if she feels uncomfortable, we anticipate it by paying attention to her body language and reset her in the healing position just to give her a little bit of a break. Lawrence is a basketball coach, so he says, let's put her back on the bench before she gets fouled.
That's awesome.
Boy. So... We can't thank you enough, but want to know, how do you handle your dog when you're walking down the very busy streets and other dog owners are like we used to be? There are just so many dogs that walk their owners, bark too intensely, and just absolutely freak her out. Thanks for the advice.
All right. Well, these people are awesome, and I'm taking that. Let's put her on back on the bench before she gets fouled. I'm taking that. So... I have the switch command, which I've been teaching people a lot, and I put on Instagram a lot, where you teach your dog, they're explaining the line perfectly. So putting the dog in the healing position where it's your dog on one side, you, and then things in the outside environment, you are open and facing those things. Now that line switches. So if you're walking with your dog on the right and someone's coming toward you on the street and their dog is on their left, the dogs are closer to each other. If that dog is barking or really excited and we have Penelope on her right, she could get a little nervous. So I switched the lead behind my back so she's now in the healing position on the other side. The cool thing about it is you can do it, I train it with a combination of two ways. Just by pulling the leash to the side and say switch, they learn to follow the lead. But when I'm doing it off leash, the way you really nail it is I'll take the long training lead out, right? And do it in a closed in environment first. And you have your dog healing on one side and you have treats in both hands. So your hands are sort of high by your chest. Then I put my hand down by my side. So let's say Penelope's on my right. I start walking forward. She's healing on my right. Then I walk a little bit ahead of her. So from her point of view, right, she can see my butt. And I shake my finger on the other side and I go, switch. She's going to come and run to the left side of me. And then I say, sit, reward. Then I walk a little bit and I say, switch. So she goes to the right. Then after a few of those, I go, switch. I go switch to the left, switch to the right, and then reward on the right. Then switch to the left, switch to the right, switch to the left again. And then you reward them from going back and forth. And then on the street, and you'll see I love posting videos of my dogs that I train doing this. I have all these dogs that are reactive in the exact same scenario. And you see the owners going switch, and the dog just whoop, and they just fly right to the other side. So the switch command is how I did that.
That's really cool.
There you go. I mean, and then there's like, and then there's like the center command, like when I'm in the deli. And there's like, you know, there's all kinds of people in New York City. There's like lunatics who are like, you know, there's this
especially nowadays.
Well, I'm walking down the
it's
west
like
side.
A free for all of crazy town.
Well,
out
I go to this one, and this guy goes woo woo woo. He starts like barking at him, and he really freaks him out. And I go, dude, can you stop doing it? He goes, ah, he likes me. Like, he's not listening to a word I'm saying.
Oh,
and it's like,
died.
I'm like, and now I'm like, I don't want to bring him in. But the cool thing is, when I put dogs in the center, they, you know, the great thing, he pops right to center. And then I go sit, and I pet him on his chin, and I'll give him rewards. And he knows, like, he's like in his case. He's like, all right, I'm safe and protected. You know, my 5'8" high giant dad has got me in the safe spot. So all those positioning commands are super helpful. You know.
My gosh, we're officially at the point where people are barking at us on the street.
Oh, dude, that people do that
amazing.
All the time.
They do that. I don't understand what that is.
Because they think...
Where they see a dog and they start, like, barking at them. I don't get
well,
that.
Well, there was a woman with a baby on my street, and she was going like this. She was, like, she was holding her... It wasn't a baby. It was probably... She was holding a kid who was, like, too old to be held. But she was, like, sitting on the lamb, and she was going... She goes... She was encouraging. She was going to say, woof, woof, woof. And she was, like, encouraging this kid to do that. And then he started going, what? Like, barking. And I'm like, lady... I would not encourage your kid to do that. She's like, oh, so she didn't think about it.
No.
But the other answer is the guy at the deli's dumb. He's dumb. He makes a great sandwich.
And we can't wrap it up any better than that. Okay. All right. On to Diana and Erica. Hi, Justin. We work at a shelter in Pennsylvania. So many amazing dogs there that just deteriorate so quickly from the stress of the environment, and it's absolutely heartbreaking. A lot of these dogs come in because people don't understand dog behavior and put them in situations that set them up to fail. Then they blame the dog, and these poor dogs are now in the shelter. We had a beautiful female Ridgeback come in who's so sweet and gentle. The owners got her and they had an older pug. She is young and playful, so they said she was smacking the pug, so he snapped at her. From what they explained, it literally seemed like dog 101. Big puppy just wants to play with the smaller dog. So we asked about training and how they introduced them, and we could tell it was one of those let's see what happens. It was hard for me not to scream during the intake. Long story short, she is starting to react poorly to the shelter. She's stressed. She's so affectionate with people, but the barking through the kennel has her freaked out, and she's becoming defensive of the other dogs. What do you suggest we do to salvage her sweet nature before this human error seals her fate? Oh, this is so...
Ugh.
Triggering for
yeah,
me.
Yeah, it's triggering for me too.
Well, if you remember, we had that in the pandemic last year where I got a call from a mutual friend of ours who one of her closest friends went and got a dog at a shelter, and that poor dog had been in the shelter for like 6 months and then brought the dog home on a Wednesday, and then on Friday promptly invited, I think it was what, like 10 to 12 family members over to meet the dog.
Yeah.
And the dog got completely freaked out and like ran like in the yeah. corner to go hide. And one of the little kids runs over and the dog didn't bite. But because the dog was barking, leave me alone, leave me alone.
Yeah.
They completely freaked out. And then all of a sudden they needed to rehome this dog. And this happens to us in rescue
all
the time.
Yeah. Yeah. So here's the deal. In Richmond, the shelters are tough. And depending where you live, they can be tougher. When I was in LA, I was just like, some of those shelters...
It's like prison.
Some of them are, but some of those shelters, I was like, can I go to camp here? Because this is, you know, a lot of the rescues are like that. Obviously, the sooner you can get this dog into foster, the better. Like, foster-based rescues are just my favorite. That's what we support at Funny for Fido. A lot of them take dogs from places like ACCs. A lot of the people who work in these shelters, I'm sure Diana and Erica have dogs of their own, foster dogs of their own, but a lot of times there's like, that's where they have to be right now. Who knows if, you know, and then when this stuff happens, a lot of times those dogs get on a certain list. They're like, well, now they're on like a aggressive dog list because it's all bureaucratic. It's that crap. So they're like, well, they can't go into foster. That happens all the time, right? So, because there's all these legalities and fosters and independent rescues, they operate under, you know, their own sort of their
so
guidelines.
So you would recommend that they reach out to a bunch of the local rescues that do foster based,
I'm
just
sure,
to try
I'm
to get
sure
her out.
I'm sure they know that,
right.
But I'm sure we're talking to educated shelter people
of course,
here. They know
yeah.
that, right? But when it comes to enrichment, in the shelter system, the more this dog could be around stable dogs and walking around those dogs, the better. The more, it's like I said before, like, if of course the dog's going to be freaked out when they're hearing dogs barking in the cage next to them, but the more that they can keep enriching this dog and the more that they can, you know, I use the term cycling like I do with, separation anxiety, where you're going in a crate, out of the crate. But the way they do it at a lot of the shelters, especially like NKLA has got this shelter downtown where their volunteer program is like, they have somebody every hour on the hour walking those dogs for 15 minutes and they have a play yard. The more that they can enrich those dogs and sort of keep their spirits up, and the more enrichment, the better. And they, you know, that I volunteered, even me, when it was like, when, you know, it's like, you know, I knew my skill set. I was like, I had to take their course. And they were like, we understand, but everybody has to do this. And they are very thorough about that. But the more people can take initiative and ask their, you know, if they have friends who are like, so many people are like, and you hear this all the time, Kristin, they're like, I love what you guys do with Funny for Fido. I just want to be able to do something like that. Well, you're a TV producer, right? I'm a dog trainer, but also
you're a professional actor.
Professional and actor comedian. And stand-up comedian. Yeah. And so I was like, all right, well, what does comedy have to do with dogs? Absolutely nothing, no. Right? But I was like, you can marry those two things. I know someone who had a bowling alley and they love dogs. I go, what should I do? I do, why don't you do a bowl for bark night? And then they started doing it like once a month, and people bring their dogs and then they have dogs for adoption and they invited the rescues there. But if people always want to help in some way, it's like, so go volunteer and walk dogs at the shelter. That's up to us as individuals. They need that. They need that. And if you have to take some course where it's just so obvious, where it's like, you know, don't walk the dog into traffic, it's like, fine. But the more enrichment they get and the more that this dog is around stable dogs, the better. And a lot of people have, you know, this is another thing. A lot of people have service dogs, like emotional support dogs, where they use those dogs as helper dogs, and they can bring the, you know, shelters are going to have different rules about this, where they can bring those dogs into the shelters to, or they can bring them outside, meet them outside to walk those dogs with them. There's this rescue upstate, and I will put the name of it in the description of this episode. But when I was looking for a new dog, Brutus is the one who came here. They upstate, I think it's in Rockland County. Every Sunday they do this dog walk, and they take the dogs out for 2 hours, and they suggest that when you're meeting the dogs for possible adoption, that you go on that dog walk with them. And their rate of keeping the rate of dogs staying stable and staying balanced is so high because they practice all this enrichment with them.
You know what could be something is one of the rescues that I worked with, they helped one of the shelters in Newark. And the shelters in Newark are terrible.
Oh, that one that we went to?
That's not even the worst one, but yeah. They're terrible.
Where the kids, where they were like screaming at the dogs and throwing stuff. Yeah.
Yes.
We see some stuff, man.
The phone call that comes at 1 a.m. and I'm like, Justin, can you come with me tomorrow to go do this thing?
It's hard. They had
this beautiful honey-colored pit bull that I fell in love with. Her name was a fawn. Thank you. Her name was Hope. And what they did was they put up a thing on social media to get walkers, but specifically dedicated to Hope because she was struggling so much more exponentially than the other dogs, which is what it sounds like Diana and Erica are talking about. And social media now...
It's a power for good or a power for evil.
Right. But especially for the dogs, a local news station in like South Jersey just got a dog adopted by running like a 30-second story on it. And so I think that possibly maybe for Diana and Erica to possibly put out a thing on social media. And as long as you do some of the prominent like hashtags and maybe even partner with your local news station where you're asking for volunteers who can come and spend time with Hope so that she knows she has something to look forward to every day for that like enrichment.
Sure.
But people that are can be dedicated. This is where seniors really, you know, do well coming into play as long as the dog doesn't pull.
Yeah. So. The other thing is I have like a lot of different shelters have they have different restrictions. So I have to assume they know most of this, because if this were from an independent rescue, they would have DM'd me this and asked me to post this, which I would have done.
Yeah, I think these are two women, and I'm guessing, and apologies, Diana and Erica, if we're guessing and we're wrong, but to me, it sounds like you are like so many of the people that I know with the state and local run, like public facilities, like animal care and control, and like that kind of stuff. And you all are wonderful, and you are so limited by how you can help because of funding, because of COVID, because of all of these things. All of these shelters have been hit so hard by COVID, and very few volunteers. And so just, on behalf of both Justin and I and Funding for Fido, thank you for everything that you're doing, and thank you for trying to help this sweet girl.
Yeah, but we see it every day. I mean, it's like, we see it. It's fun when people send me these things. And by the way, there's times where I get, listen, I appreciate that people look to me as a hub and a source of things, but there's people like that drive me crazy on social media, and they're going to hear it. When someone just sends me a picture, they go, Justin, this dog's suffering. And they just send me a picture. They go, and I go, and then I look on their page, and I go, and what did you do today? You're helpless.
What did you do?
You're helpless and powerless. I go, they're like, no, but you save pit bulls. I go, right. And I save a lot of pit. And you're trapped under a couch right now? I'm the person who saves pit bulls. You're the person who just like, you know, has an emotion about something and then just throws things at other people. Like, that makes me nuts. I'm like, everybody's empowered here.
Right.
Right. And the only reason, like, you are my partner in running a charity because we were like, hey, let's go do this. So anybody can do these things. And, you know, there's such an influx. I try to help as many as I can.
You
know what I mean? But when people are sort of like, they play this like, oh, this is so sad, but what, somebody should do something.
Yes.
Somebody else should do something. You know, and then there's a list of things you have in your day. And then they get upset when I call it like that. And I go, listen, go walk that dog.
Well, and I think the other thing is you had to go through this with me, which a lot of people are not cut out for this, in the sense that they're just like, I can't look at that. Like, it's just too depressing. But you can go raise money.
Right.
And by raising money, you're not like getting yourself heartbroken. You're not putting yourself in the mix, because it does take a very specific personality. 100%. I get that question all the time. You have even said to me, why do you keep doing this to yourself?
No, there's a certain amount of exposure.
It's really hard, but it is not hard to raise money. And I have a very dear friend of mine. Her name is Carla Mohan, and she runs Near and Far Animal Foundation.
She's great.
And she's amazing. And
she's been on an episode of this.
Yes. Yeah. And so I was just on a Clubhouse with her, and we were giving people tips on, there are things that you do in your daily life where you could easily raise like even $100. $100, if you went and you lived in Pennsylvania and you managed to raise like even just $100, go give that to Diana and Erica at their, because they will find a way to do something with that $100.
How about my accountant? He's like, he's busy all day. He's got three kids. And he was like, yeah, I want to, you know, he does the accounting for Funding for Fido for free. It's like, that's how you're helping. Like, you just saved me $1,000 a year that now I can feed dogs with, instead of having to pay the bill for this. Thank you.
Right. This isn't, and that's the problem with, I've been in 501c3 since I was probably 13 years old, just because my parents, and I understand that for a lot of people, it's very overwhelming. They're like, how do I get involved? How do I get started? It's really, it's not this like monumental thing. It's actually very, very easy. And even if you just give a little bit, you'd be surprised how grateful people are.
Oh,
they're not going to try to, it's not like this black hole where they're just going to suck you in.
Yeah,
and then you're going to lose, you know, your life and your work and all this other stuff, because now you're doing that.
If you personally say, hey, everybody, this is something that's important to me. Anybody who wants to
even
support,
even the Facebook
please.
Fundraisers are great.
Yeah. Let's move on to the next
one. We're
going to
move on to Gail. All right. Gail says, hi, I watched your video on gentle turning and noticed that giant Dane had a head collar on.
Prince.
Oh, Prince. Oh, the Danes. The Dane. We could have a whole episode devoted to just the Danes.
Just the Danes.
I have a Great Pyrenees avalanche. Oh, my gosh. And a Morkie snowball.
Ooh. Dog names of the episode.
Yep.
I love when people do that.
Yes.
And I love when white dogs are named after like a snow disaster.
Yeah. Avalanche and snowball. Right.
I love that.
Like I love like a little tiny like white dog and it's named Yeti.
Yeah.
These girls play nicely together, but when we are out on walks, they pull in different directions. They know how to heal when I have one on either side of me, but there are times I don't want to be in training mode. I just want to walk and talk on my earbuds without having to say heal in the middle of my conversation. They get into sniff mode, and then one goes one way and the other goes the other way, and then Snowball ends up under her sister, and then the leashes are in the knot, and now I'm playing limbo trying to get them both untied. I looked up head collars on Amazon, but there are a few types. Which ones are worth their salt? Thanks so much from Denver.
Oh, I love Denver.
Oh, they've got Avalanche and Snowball in Denver.
Very appropriate. Oh. I'm a fan. I'm a fan of Gail. Okay, so the head collars are great because you're leading dogs right from the cockpit. And I understand, when I have dogs staying for the weekend, Arthur is like this sniffer who lifts his leg on every single thing, even when he's like just pissing blanks. And then Brutus goes the other way. And when it's a big dog and a little dog, it's like, it's kind of difficult. Cause then I get this, right? I get the annoyance of this. And when it's two big dogs, I can do the thing where I tie two knots and I put one knot between my index and my FU finger. I don't know what that is. And then the other one between my pinky and the ring finger. Right. So I sort of, and I show videos on how to do this because their heads are at the same height.
I don't know how you do that. I'm making it's like a horse rein.
It's like how
it's
you,
the
it,
claw.
It looks like a claw. So it's like a horse rein, but because their heads are at the same height, they're staying in parallel. Right. When it's a big dog and a little dog, it's different. So the head collars are great because it's like you're leading them from the front. There's not going to be much pull there or resistance. Now, there's two main types of head collars. There's the gentle leader and the halty. I use the halty. Here's why. The halty's padded around the nose, right? And it's got a safety that goes from the active ring under the chin to their collar. Let's say they have a martingale collar on. In the event that the head collar comes off, because it can, there's times it can, the dogs aren't loose. So the halty is the one that I think is the best, and those are the ones I use. My closets are full of them. Now, they're not great. They're not going to work on very snub-nosed dogs. The other thing is the gentle leader, because of the way it's designed, for dogs that have, it's never going to work on a pug or a French bull. You're never going to get these on pugs, French bulldogs, you're never going to get these on. They just don't have enough schnoz.
Schnoz.
Right. Excuse me. But for dogs that have shorter snouts but still have a snout, the gentle leader, the style of that allows for a little less space between where their ears are and the end of their noses. I know it's hard to visualize this, but just trust me. So when I do have to use the gentle leader, I just go get, I get a, like they have these slip leads that you use to make choke change, which I don't use, but they have fabric versions of them. And the way they work is you sew the center of the lead through the ringlet so you can put something around it. So I just make one of those. And I you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's hard to explain. If you understand how...
No, I understand how they fit together.
How a slip lead goes on.
But for someone else, they're...
Right.
Just look it up on Google
right.
Images.
Right. It's a string with two metal circles yep. on either side. And what you do is you take the middle of the string, you sew it through, and then you have like a slip. So what I'll do is I'll put one bar, let's call it a bar, or one lanyard of the, I'm trying to think about how to say, one strap of the gentle leader. I'll wrap this around it and then clip it to their collar. I do it like that. So I make one. But for these type of dogs, for the breeds that she's talking about, well, the Morkie may need that. So, okay, so I changed that. So the Great Pyrenees is going to be fine, probably in like a size 4 halty. And then you may have to makeshift a gentle leader and do what I'm saying.
Like you're
for
almost
the
kind of creating a bridge
yes.
between the two
which you're
pieces.
Which most likely you're
which
not.
Which are fine.
You're not going to need it, though.
Right.
You're probably not going to need. You're not. Like, the they're if you have them sized right, they're often not going to come off, but they can.
Right.
So that's it. There you go.
Well, and that's good to people to know because, you know, that's a whole other thing, which we should talk about that on another episode of like there. I get a lot of people that their dogs are slipping their collars.
Well, the Martingale, they can.
So the last one is from Keith and Carlos. Hi, we are NYC locals, just like you.
Bummer.
Our
I hate it here.
We're so sorry. Our Vishla, these poor dogs now. Our Vishla just got kicked out of daycare because he snapped at another dog. A lot of dogs been getting kicked out of daycare lately.
I'll go into that.
Now, the interesting thing is that he isn't what we would label as aggressive. We are not those clueless dog owners. We take him to dog parks, and when he gets uncomfortable with another dog's play, he will just give a warning bite to let them know to back off. We call it an air bite because he's not attacking or really closing teeth on them. If they don't back off, we kind of say playfully, come on, Lucas, and find something else to do, or leave if the park is a circus. The daycare said we need to get aggressive dog training. Wow. We aren't the types to ignore issues, but something about this just doesn't seem accurate. Is there something we could be missing here? We thought he was just setting boundaries. Thanks in advance. There's a lot to unpack here.
Let's just keep it simple. Yeah. The air bite and the way you're doing it, exactly how I would do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, like they're allowed to express themselves and they're allowed to say, hey, back off. And they don't have hands, they have teeth. And he's not attacking other dogs. However, in a doggy daycare situation in New York City, a lot of these are just small. They're rooms. They're indoor rooms. And even if there is a yard, it's like there's a lot of dogs packed in. There aren't really experts there. I'm sure there's trained people there, but there's also people who just need a day gig and love dogs and may not be the most experienced with them. And this is a Vishla who's a very active dog. It's a young Vishla. Right. You know, they're like dirt bikes. So if dogs are expected to just be calm in that room and they're not given like big open spaces to run around in and there's another dog that's annoying your Vishla, I don't know what they're supposed to do, but they probably have behaviors that they can handle or can't handle. So my suggestion is you get a dog walker. I've always thought that I've always thought in urban environments where dogs are not outside, dog walkers are the best way to go because they're doing something constructive. They're walking around. The amount of exercise that they are going to get on an hour-long walk, which is a few miles, is going to be a lot more than in a room. And I also don't like indoor daycare facilities because if dogs have they're in a small space. There's a lot of bacteria. There's peeing and pooping all over the floor. If one dog's doing it, that tends to rub off on other ones so it can reverse their housebreaking, but it just doesn't sound like that's the environment for your dog, and it sounds like you kind of understand the right environments. And also, just because a dog has an expression of something that's aggressive, to label it an aggressive dog is not fair. That's like if I said, you know, the elevator situation we were talking about earlier. If there's another dog on the other side of that, or the Westie. Like, you know, they just said it. Like, if they're walking and the dog's on that side and another on the side of a dog coming toward them and that dog's barking and barking and barking and that dog barks back and lunges back, it's like, is that an inherently aggressive dog? Not really. If someone's screaming at me in the street and I feel threatened, I'm allowed to go, hey, you better get the hell away from me. Like, I'm allowed to do that.
Right.
Right? And your dog is allowed to push back when it's being pushed. So I wouldn't put your dog in an environment to be pushed, but I think your appraisal of it is accurate.
And also, just to bring it back to your individualized approach, which we started off with, and this is a little thing I like to call full circle, is an individualized approach.
It's full circle. This
is a Vishla. This is a dog that is a working dog. There is a mind body. This is not a dog that you go take to a park, you throw a ball for it for 35 minutes, get it all good and tired, and then it doesn't need anything else.
No.
This is a dog where there is a mind body connection. And so having a walker, and listen, right now, having a walker twice a day is the same price as having this doggy daycare thing. And so you're not necessarily losing anything, in my opinion, from pivoting to a walker, because the walker is going to at least vary up their experience every day. They could do a pack walk if they want to do a pack walk.
They can always suggest an
individual walk. They can do a play walk. They can even go to a dog park. You just get more bang for your buck. And again, you get that individualized approach. So kudos to you.
It's not diluted attention.
Right. Kudos to you, Keith and Carlos. You are doing the right thing. You are great paw parents. And keep staying on top of it. Always go with your instincts. And I just wouldn't send that dog back to doggy daycare. And I would just
or that one.
Or just get a really good walker.
All right, that's all for today. Guys, thank you so much for your questions. We really love interacting with you. Once again, you can ask us anything you like at patreon.com/TLOD, and it's at The Language of Dogs on all social media platforms. I'll be putting up more videos. I have the separation anxiety video that's been taking us months to edit because it's four different dogs in that video, and I'm being very thorough about it. That's going to come out on YouTube soon. Until next week, everybody. Oh, you know what? I'm going to say this. Don't forget. Be patient. Have fun. Expect progress, not perfection. And now I'll say, until next week, happy dog training.